The president made his speech of acceptance as 150,000 looked on and as 50 million listened in by radio.
This is a day of national consecration. And I am certain that on this day, my fellow Americans expect that on my induction into the presidency, I will address them with a candor and a decision which the present situation of our people impels. This is preeminently the time to speak the truth and boldly from honestly facing conditions in our country today. This great nation will endure as it has endured, will revive and will prosper. And yet our distress comes from no failure of substance. We are stricken by no plague of locusts. Compared with the perils which our forefathers conquered because they believed and were not afraid, we have still much to be thankful for. Our greatest primary task is to put people to work. This is no unsolvable problem if we face it wisely and courageously. It can be accomplished in part by direct recruiting by the government itself, treating the task as we would treat the emergency of a war, but at the same time, through this employment, accomplishing greatly needed projects to stimulate and reorganize the use of our great natural resources. Plenty is at our doorstep, but a generous use of it languishes in the very sight of the supply.
Under my constitutional duty to recommend the measures that a stricken nation in the midst of a stricken world may require. These measures, or such other measures, as the Congress may build out of its experience and wisdom, I shall seek within my constitutional authority to bring to speedy adoption. But in the event that the Congress shall fail to take one of these two courses, in the event that the national emergency is still critical, I shall not evade the clear course of duty that will then confront me. I shall ask the Congress for the one remaining instrument to meet the crisis. Broad executive power to wage a war against the emergency as great as the power that would be given to me if we were in fact invaded by a foreign foe. This nation is asking for action, and action now. In this dedication of a nation, we humbly ask the blessing of God. May he protect each and every one of us. May he guide me in the days to come.
On the Sunday following his inauguration, the very next day, the president took his problem to the great counselor. He went to church and bowed his head in prayer as he'd done on the morning of March 4th before proceeding to the Capitol to take the oath. While we cannot know what Franklin D. Roosevelt confided to his God or asked of his God, we do know that the people felt an even greater reassurance in this simple act of devotion on the part of the man who had so thrilled and uplifted them. And then, without the loss of an hour, he called in his Secretary of the Treasury, William H. Woodin, and planned and executed those brilliant and decisive strokes by which the country's financial structure was preserved. By declaring a bank holiday, he halted the growing panic and provided a breathing spell in which to readjust credit and provide more currency. March the 9th was a notable day in our history, with Congress eagerly accepting the President's recommendation. By a vote of 73-7, the United States Senate hastened to pass the president's banking measure. It was the most emphatic vote of confidence which that body had given to the head of the nation in many a long year. In the House, the new Speaker, white-haired Henry W. Rainey of Illinois, was at the throttle and running the legislative locomotive in the direction that his party leader, the President, was demanding it should go. Rainey knew it was no time for quibbling. Straight through, he drove the Roosevelt measures. Intense interest was shown in the House as the clerk read the President's great economy bill, which planned the saving of $500 million. And with the banking situation smoothing out, the President went on the air on the night of Sunday, March the 12th, and talked to the people in simple, friendly terms.
The bank holiday, while resulting in many cases in great inconvenience, is affording us the opportunity to supply the currency necessary to meet the situation. No sound bank is a dollar worse off than it was when it closed its doors. It is possible, of course, in a very few places, that when the banks resume, a very few people who have not recovered from their fear may again begin withdrawals. Let me make it clear that the banks will take care of all needs. And it is my belief that hoarding during the past week has become an exceedingly unfashionable pastime. After all, there is an element in the readjustment of our financial system that is more important than currency, more important than gold, and that is the confidence of the people themselves. Confidence and courage are the essentials of success in carrying out our plan. You people must have faith. You must not be stampeded by rumors or guesses. Let us unite in banishing fear. We have provided the machinery to restore our financial system, and it is up to you to support and make it work. It is your problem, my friends, no less than it is mine. Together, we cannot fail.